Netflix dived 25% in the after hours trading, which will certainly weigh on Nasdaq today, which rallied 2% yesterday, despite the IMF and the World Bank cutting their growth forecasts and warning of higher inflation, the ugly Chinese data, and, well, the Federal Reserve's Bullard talking about a 75 basis point hike that could not be ruled out. So welcome, this is Swissquote's daily market talk. Netflix dived more than 25% in the after-hours trading after announcing that the subscriptions fell by 200,000 in the first quarter. Wow, that was totally unexpected. I mean, the market was expecting lower subscriptions than the previous quarters, but that was around 2.5 million subscribers and not a 200,000 loss. Plus, the company said that there could be 2 million less people on their platform this quarter, which is a big punch in investors' face. Well, the war in Ukraine certainly had a significant impact as Netflix isolated some 700,000 subscribers from Russia, but then the rest is simply due to the rising subscription fees that apparently didn't please the users in an environment of fast rising inflation and falling purchasing power. Even though we know that the household savings remain strong, at least in the US, well, it seems like Netflix may not be aware they would like to spend their extra cash. So the knee-jerk market reaction to Netflix results was quite dramatic and will certainly plummet the good mood in Nasdaq, which rallied more than 2% at yesterday's trading session. But the futures are pointing to the downside at the time I'm talking here, as a massive dive that we're about to see in Netflix shares will certainly pull the rest of the index along with it. We could especially see other streaming stocks take a hit as well, as Disney, for example, fell more than 4% post-market. A Katie Wood favorite Roku fell more than 6%, and CNN Plus is simply not doing well, with about 150,000 subscriptions only since its launch end of this March. So does it mean that the shiny pandemic days are over, or does it simply mean that there are just so many subscription services right now that people just don't know where to go anymore and it's just too costly to pay for all of them? So the time will show what will be up with these streaming services. But other than Netflix, well, the European markets traded in the red on the back of the escalation of the war in Ukraine as Russia launched what they call the second phase of the war in the eastern Ukraine now. But the investor mood was rather strong in the US on Tuesday. So the three major US indices gained as the S&P 500 added more than 1.5% and Nasdaq rallied another 2%. But the news, other than the falling oil prices, weren't necessarily supportive of a market euphoria in the US either. First, the World Bank cut its growth forecast by nearly a percentage point yesterday from 4.1 to 3.2%, which includes a 4.1% economic contraction in Europe and Central Asia, mainly due to the Ukrainian war. And IMF followed the World Bank in cutting its growth forecast from 4.4 to 3.6% in 2022 and projected an even faster inflation. So they see inflation for this year at 5.7% in advanced economies and at 8.7% in emerging and developing countries. And yes, the crude oil fell 4.5% to $102 per barrel, but is already trading up this morning as the price pullbacks in crude oil are still seen as interesting dip buying opportunities, as the supply side remains very, very much problematic with the Ukrainian war, the OPEC's unwillingness to pump more oil, the rising gas prices, the unrest in Libya, and Houthi attacks in Saudi Arabia, and so. So the slowdown in the demand side is certainly slowing down the positive trend, but it doesn't necessarily weigh enough to reverse the positive trend that we see since the last couple of months. Then, speaking of slowing demand, the Chinese data released this week showed that the imports fell, the industrial production slowed sharply in March due to new COVID lockdowns, the unemployment advanced to 5.8%, which is above the government's target of 5.5%, and the retail sales tumbled near 2% during the month and 3.5% since last March, which is the worst annual drop since 2020. And the government remains stubborn in keeping the zero COVID policy in place in China, and the places that are actually locked down stand for about 25% of the country's GDP, according to JP Morgan, because yes, we are talking about cities like Shanghai and Shenzhen, where the economic heart of the country beats or doesn't beat anymore. So although we hear that Tesla, for example, will gently start production in its Shanghai Giga factory, where employees will actually be sleeping at work, well, it's still hard to see the end of the lockdown system in China, because people I spoke with say that each time there is a case, for example, in their compound, they are locked in for 7 more days. And if there is a case in their building, well, they are locked down for another 2 weeks, and the cases keep coming up as they are regularly tested and they just keep staying home. So China is becoming a serious headache for the world economy this year, as the factory shutdowns and logistic disruptions could only amplify the supply chain problems and add an additional pressure on the already very rapidly rising inflation, which is already at multi-decade highs in Europe and in the US, for example. And to fight that inflation, St. Louis Fed President James Bullard said that he wouldn't rule out a 75 basis point increase in the US rates, although this is not his base case for the May meeting. So he said that the Fed funds rate should be lifted to minimum to 3.5% by the end of this year. So funny enough, the market didn't react to his words. They went mostly on price at yesterday's trading session, but we still saw the US yields trending higher. The US 2-year yield, for example, continued to push higher as the US 10-year yield is now preparing to test the 3% mark for the very first time since the end of 2018. Gold, on the other hand, couldn't consolidate gains near the $2,000 per ounce mark, and the failure to move above this psychological level sent the price of an ounce down to $1,945 this morning. So the geopolitical tensions should keep the downside limited in gold, but the rising US yields sure drives a safe haven demand towards other alternatives, and the US dollar is one place that amasses a part of these geopolitical inflows. So the US dollar continues gaining against the major counterparts. The US dollar index is now comfortably consolidating about the 100 mark, and the gains against the Japanese yen are unstoppable as the yen fell to the lowest level in almost 20 years, and the pair is now preparing to test the 130 mark on growing divergence between an increasingly hawkish Federal Reserve and a still dovish BOJ, given that the Japanese don't fight the same inflation battle than the rest of the world, at least for now. But the Japanese officials are getting tense with the rapid fall in the yen's valuation, given that Japan imports pretty much everything, and a too soft yen could actually harm the economy. So it is possible that the rapid yen depreciation will call for a concrete action in Japan, as the verbal intervention from the officials don't really seem to be sufficient to stop the bleeding in the yen for now. A month ago, the dollar yen was trading near 120 level, and now we are above the 128 mark. So it could be time for a healthy downside correction in the USD Japanese yen. Now, a last word for today. Tesla is due to announce its first quarter earnings after the bell today, and Barron's says prepare for disappointment as the COVID lockdown in China and high raw material prices may weigh on the Tesla's first quarter results despite the record car deliveries in the first quarter, which, according to Barron's, remained below the Wall Street expectations still. So, Tesla shares have been seeing great support from the 100-day moving average level, which stands around $975 per share. So, any disappointment could send the stock price below that level, but Tesla is full of surprises, and a good surprise is all we hope for Tesla at the earnings confessional today. So this is all for today. I'm İpek Özkardeşkaya, and thank you for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and it has been insightful to you. So please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your reactions, and your questions below as usual, and follow us on Instagram, on Twitter, and on LinkedIn for regular market updates. And subscribe, of course, to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow, and until then, good day trading.